Today on Christian World News, Israel on the brink. Leaders work to repair what's being called the worst rift in U.S.-Israeli relations in 35 years. And an ancient synagogue sets off Muslim protests in Jerusalem. Also, an American pastor in Morocco speaks out about the campaign against foreign Christian workers and how it's affecting the church. Plus, his father helped start the terror group Hamas. But this man went on a different path. We'll tell you how he became a follower of Jesus Christ. Welcome to Christian World News. I'm Wendy Griffith. George Thomas is on assignment. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu will meet with U.S. President Barack Obama when he visits Washington this week. The meeting comes in the wake of what some describe as the biggest rift in U.S.-Israeli relations in 35 years. The U.S. wants Israel to cancel plans for new construction in East Jerusalem. Israel's announcement of the building project delayed peace talks with the Palestinians and created a diplomatic dust-up with the U.S. Meantime, the dedication of a Jerusalem synagogue that had been destroyed in 1948 became the latest flashpoint in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Chris Mitchell has that story from Jerusalem.
Sporadic violence erupted in and around Jerusalem on Tuesday after Hamas called for a day of rage following the rededication of a centuries-old synagogue in the Jewish quarter of Jerusalem's Old City.
This is the Herva Synagogue. It's been described as more than just a house of prayer, but as a venue for historical events and a symbol of the yearning of the Jewish people for a return to their homeland.
Palestinian clerics are claiming the rebuilding of a synagogue is a provocation. One Jewish tradition says once the synagogue is rebuilt, Jews would then begin to rebuild the temple on the Temple Mount, site of the Al-Aqsa Mosque and the Golden Dome of the Rock. The synagogue was first built in the early 1700s and destroyed in 1721. 140 years later, a new synagogue was built. The Jordanian Legion destroyed that synagogue during Israel's War of Independence in 1948.
Now the Jews have returned in fulfillment of prophecy. They've rebuilt their synagogue, a place to give glory to God.
Jewish editor Moshe Kempinski said the uproar over the synagogue doesn't make sense.
The whole world is actually having a very difficult time with it and calling it a provocation, even though that's illogical, meaning the greatest provocation was destroying a house of God, not rebuilding it.
The dedication of the Herva reinforces the connection of the Jewish people to Jerusalem. It comes in the midst of the worst crisis in U.S.-Israel relations in decades, sparked by an Israeli building project in a Jewish neighborhood in the eastern part of the city, where Palestinians want the capital of a future state. The U.S. is demanding Israel halt building in all Jewish neighborhoods in the eastern part of the city. In an interview with Israeli Army Radio, Elliot Abrams, former advisor to Presidents Reagan and Bush, blamed the Obama administration for the crisis.
The administration was very hostile to the Netanyahu government. They were hostile before he did anything. So one argument you can make is that they really don't like dealing with the Netanyahu government and that they want to see if they can get rid of it and bring down the coalition.
In the meantime, Netanyahu says every prime minister since 1967 has built in the Holy City, and he won't stop either. Given the standoff, it appears there could be tough times ahead for U.S.-Israel relations and in Jerusalem. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
John Waghi has lived in Israel for years, where he worked in our Jerusalem bureau. John, how big is the strain on the relationship right now between the U.S. and Israel?
Well, the strain is significant between the U.S. government and Israel. The American people, I don't think, have much of a problem with Netanyahu's policies. I think that Barack Obama does, and that's... He's been leaning on Netanyahu to have your Secretary of State castigate the Prime Minister of Israel for 45 minutes for allowing the building of 1,600 homes. That's a lot of pressure.
Well, what's the danger for Israel?
Well, the danger for Israel is that the rift with the U.S. makes it more difficult for Israel to defend itself, possibly. There's a threat, as Chris mentioned in his story, to the Netanyahu government itself if the coalition were to fall apart because of bad relationships with the United States. But there's a greater danger, Wendy, I think, for the United States than there is for Israel. And the book of Zechariah says that Jerusalem will become a burdensome stone, and those who pick up the burden will be cut to pieces. And I don't think very many world capitals in Europe or in the United Nations or in Israel are paying much attention to the Bible at this point.
Well, every president tries to make peace in the Middle East. How does President Obama rank, you know, compared to other former presidents?
Well, President Obama, I think, believes that he can mediate between the Muslim, Christian, and Jewish worlds by imposing a peace agreement on parties that aren't even ready to talk yet. And it's not the Israelis that aren't ready to talk. It's the Palestinians who have refused to even sit down with Benjamin Netanyahu. Mm. Now, what Obama has been doing is forcing more Israeli concessions, stop building in all of Jerusalem. But what have the Palestinians conceded? What concession has the White House asked of the Palestinians?
Mm. Nothing, right?
Hard to name one, hard to come up with one.
Well, what do you think will come out of this meeting between Bibi Netanyahu and President Obama?
Well, I think there will be a lot of public relations kind of grandstanding. You know, the last time that Netanyahu was in town, President Obama didn't even have him come for a publicity photo. They did it at night on the QT. I think this time there'll be a little more public stance, everything trying to smooth over this image of a huge rift, you know. But behind the scenes, I'm not sure it's going to be any more quiet than it's been.
All right, John Waagi, thanks so much for your insights. Sure. We appreciate it. Well, attacks on a Christian community in Egypt left more than 20 people injured this week, three of them in critical condition. Muslims firebombed Christian homes during the attack. A Coptic bishop says Muslims began rioting after an imam called for jihad against infidels in a Friday sermon. Many Christians hid inside a Coptic community center for 10 hours while Egyptian security forces fought to restore order. More Christians are being kicked out of Morocco. At least 70 missionaries have now been expelled. The Islamic government says they were proselytizing and breaking the law. Recently, CBN's Mark Martin spoke by Skype with an American pastor in Morocco about the concerns for Christians still there.
Well, for 10 years, Christians have felt the freedom of the government to help with charitable projects, with some of the social needs in Morocco. Caring for abandoned children, handicap centers, any number of different projects. And now the events of this last week is calling into question whether that's still going to be possible.
The most unexpected police raid happened at an orphanage run by Christian families.
This came as a complete shock to have the police come and give 7 hours notice, took the kids into the dining hall in one part of the parking lot, the parents on the other side, and announced to both groups that the parents were leaving that night. And they had 7 hours to say goodbye and to pack their things and leave under police escort, with the kids crying, and it was just a horrific scene.
Now the future of these 33 orphans adds to the anxiety felt by the remaining Christians.
I knew these children well. This was not an institutional orphanage. This was a family-based children's home, where parents had a maximum of 8 children, and so it was really a family style, and so they took these kids from their only parents they've known. So that's been very difficult for me to process, and then plus there's the anxiety when I come home and I look up the street before I come in to see if there's any cars in front of my house. So I've been telling people in some ways that we might have a sense of what it was like in the book of Acts when Saul was on his rampage, and asking questions, who's next? Did you hear who they got? Who are they going to get next?
What can we do to help Morocco?
Well, for Christians, the most important thing to do is to pray. We're very encouraged at the number of articles that are being written. We encourage people to contact their senators, their congressmen, to put pressure on the government. We would love to see the government release the children and allow the children to leave the country and go to be with their parents, or to allow the parents to come back and to be with their children. But we think that the pressure on the government needs to increase. They need to know that these actions have consequences.
You can see the rest of our interview with Pastor Jack Wald at our website, cwnews.org. Coming up, he helped his family survive the Cambodian genocide. Today, he's helping deliver his countrymen from spiritual darkness.
CWNews.org, your constant news source on the World Wide Web. Find daily updates on the global church. Watch the weekly broadcast.
Three former presidents come together to honor the life and ministry.
Also available in podcast. The in-depth insights into our reporter blogs.
Taliban kidnapped at least 18 South Korean Christians.
Your online news source for complete coverage of the global church.
Thanks, Pete. Hi, I'm Terry Musin. We receive so many letters and emails from viewers who say their day just isn't the same if they don't see the 700 Club. That's why I'm so excited to tell you that you'll never have to miss another show. The 700 Club's here for you every Monday through Friday with stories of hope and encouragement, practical information to make your life better, and insight you need to make sense of what's going on in the world. It's never been easier to see the 700 Club. Even if breaking news interrupts us, you can still watch the show. Call this number or go to CBN.com to get this list of all the different channels in your area where you can see the 700 Club. With the 700 Club airing on so many channels, you can choose the one that's best for you. So remember, no matter what happens, whether it's big or small, you can always see the 700 Club.
Call or log on to CBN.com for this important information.
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
In the United Kingdom, Christians feel their freedoms are being eroded bit by bit. The government's reaction to a Muslim girl's conversion to Christianity is just one case. Peter Wooding reports from Leeds, England.
The British government has revoked the registration of a Christian foster parent after a 16-year-old Muslim girl converted to Christianity while in her care. None of the parties in the case can be named to protect the girl, despite her no longer being a minor. When the girl decided she wanted to be baptized in a church, government officials said the foster parent failed in her duty to preserve the girl's religion and should have used her influence to prevent the baptism from going ahead. The Muslim girl in her late teens was interested in exploring Christianity before she was placed in foster care. The foster parent says she did not encourage the girl to change her faith and even offered to take her to places where she could practice Islam. However, the girl insisted on exploring the Christian faith and eventually decided to be baptized. The Christian Institute's Mike Judge says he can't understand the government's objection to allowing the girl to choose to change her faith.
There is absolutely no indication that the Muslim girl was in any way pressurized. She decided to become a Christian of her own free will.
Judge says this case highlights the sort of double standards that Christians are facing in modern Britain.
I cannot imagine that if this was about a Christian girl deciding to become a Muslim, or if this was about a Christian girl deciding to become an atheist, that the city officials would have clamped down on this foster carer.
The foster parent's lawyer, Nigel Priestley, says there is no evidence that the girl has suffered harm for changing her religion. He argues that the authorities failed to listen to the girl's views. Priestley says the event that provoked the government was the decision by the girl to be baptized.
The local authority took the view that this was a devastating change in the plan for the life of this particular young woman. She had the right to choose, which she did. And we say that it's entirely disproportionate to say that because a young woman makes that choice whilst in the care of a foster carer, that it should fold back onto her, that in some way she should have done something to stop her.
A government spokesman declined to comment because of the girl's age at the time of the incident. A court has ruled that the foster parent can appeal the decision. Her case is set to be heard here at Leeds High Court April 27th.
Christians hope not only will she win the case, but that this case will reinforce the right of people to freely change their faith without fear of legal consequences. Peter Wooding for CBN News, Leeds, England.
Thanks, Peter. Vietnamese pastors told evangelist Luis Palau this past week that big changes are taking place in Vietnam. They discussed a recent Christian celebration that drew 40,000 people, all with government permission. Palau met with hundreds of pastors in Hanoi and Ho Chi Minh City. He urged them to respect the communist nation's leaders and pray for them. He also challenged church leaders to make big plans and pray great prayers. Palau's own plans include getting permission to hold massive public meetings in Vietnam. In neighboring Cambodia, one of the leaders of the bloody Khmer Rouge regime has been on trial for crimes against humanity. CBN Asia correspondent Lucille Tolusum was in Phnom Penh, where she met with some of the victims of the killing fields.
For 1 year now, King Nguyễn Kiều, better known as Doit, has been on trial in the UN-backed Khmer Rouge tribunal for alleged crimes against humanity. He was chief of the Tuol Slang prison, where more than 17,000 Cambodians were unlawfully detained, tortured, and executed. Chan Nat was among the handful who survived the inhuman conditions at the prison. He says he painted his horrific experiences to expose the truth about the oppressive Khmer Rouge regime and serve as a warning against human rights abuses.
Here in this painting for 1 month, we were all lying on the floor tied to one another while the soldiers beat us up. Here we are chained to a man who was already 11 hours dead. He died of starvation. It was like I was living in hell.
More than 2 million Cambodians, one-third of the population, perished under Pol Pot's Khmer Rouge rule. Like other teenagers, Lin Kim Chai was subjected to hard labor in the fields, digging 5 cubic meters a day. He dug from 4:30 in the morning to 11 in the evening. Failure to meet the quota for 3 consecutive days resulted in merciless execution.
They just use the stick to hit on your neck and then push you into the grave and cover with the soil. 148 of my friends was killed because they cannot finish the work.
But the most difficult trial for him was when the Khmer Rouge soldiers ordered Chai to kill his own mother. She was judged as being a loose woman for being pregnant without her husband. No one knew that she secretly met with her husband, who was in hiding.
I told them that I will offer my mom to do whatever you want her to do. They used my mom as a slave in the family of Pol Pot, just like prostitution. My mom just cried and cried. And then I hold my mom, I said, okay, you and me will be alive.
Because of his determination, Chai managed to get an education with the help of Christian missionaries. He learned English by reading the Bible. And when he got seriously ill in his nervous system, he was miraculously healed when the missionaries prayed for him. But it was when he translated the English Bible to Khmer that one day the Holy Spirit enlightened him and he finally understood God's saving grace. Today, Chai is a pastor and runs his own educational center that caters to poor students.
This is my desire, my purpose, to win soul for Christ. In the Bible said, whoever say that Jesus Christ is Savior and invite him to the heart of them, surely be saved no matter what verse your past is.
But alongside God's mercies, is facing the consequences for committing one of the worst crimes against humanity. Lucille Talusan, Phnom Penh, Cambodia.
When Christian World News returns, he's a former prince of Hamas. Now he calls himself a son of God.
It's the one thing news viewers can agree on.
They want change.
Now, the world's leading Christian news organization brings you national, international news and analysis throughout the day. Mornings, the busy lunch hour, late afternoon, and evenings. It's news with a Christian perspective whenever you want it.
Available on the web 24/7 at cbnnews.com.
You and I live in a visible world, yet there is at work all around us an invisible kingdom of unlimited goodness and power. In the Bible, Jesus Christ has given us fundamental kingdom principles that are as valid in our world today as the law of gravity. These principles can overcome every obstacle or circumstance we encounter and guarantee our success.
Taken from his national bestseller, The Secret Kingdom, this latest DVD by Pat Robertson reveals how God's kingdom works, principles that produce exceptional growth and development, unchanging keys that build success in business, finances, health, relationships, and much more.
You can reach from a world of impossibilities into a realm of limitless possibility and power.
The Secret Kingdom by Pat Robertson. Available now.
As co-host of the 700 Club, I see incredible stories of God's faithfulness to our viewers every day. It builds our faith to see what God is doing in people's lives. Perhaps you've seen a miracle in your finances. We'd like to share your story with others so that they too can be encouraged. Please call 1-800-759-0700 or log on to cbn.com. We want to hear from you. Your life can inspire others.
Mossam Hassan Yosef grew up as Palestinian royalty. He's the son of one of the founders of the Islamic terrorist group Hamas. But as he got older, Mossam became disillusioned and began questioning his Islamic faith. In his new book, Son of Hamas, Yosef tells how he forsook terrorism and found true peace through faith in Jesus Christ. One of the consequences of that act is that his father has disowned him. Recently, Yosef talked about his conversion and the consequences with CBN reporter Dale Hurd.
Your father, who you dearly love, has disowned you. How does that make you feel?
I know my father's heart. I know the Muslim people's heart. They have a great zeal to God. They want to serve him. But this make me insist to fight the cause, the real cause behind this disowning or this position of my father. It's not his heart. It's the authority of the God of the Quran above him. So he's simply doing the will of his God. And my problem, more than any time in the past, is with the God of Quran.
And you've described that as a much different God than the God of the Bible.
To Muslims, the God of the Quran means God Almighty. Allah, the translation for the word Allah, means God, God Almighty. Now, but unfortunately, the God of the Quran, if we compare his personality to the personality of the God of the Bible, we will find the difference. So it doesn't matter if Satan come and appear and tell people, I am God or I'm Jesus Christ, and people start to follow him. This doesn't make him Jesus Christ because he has a name. What matters how he acts. From their fruits, we know them. And the fruits of the God of the Quran is killing, terrorism, beating women, killing children. This is the real fruit of the God of the Quran.
What happened that led you to pray the prayer?
So it took me 6 years to study. It's that transformation wasn't over one night. It was gradually, and I had to study Christianity, Islam from the beginning, and study other religions, not only Christianity and Islam. Also, I considered at some point not to believe in any religion, and I was going nowhere. The only path I found peace. And I think it's good for me and good for all humankind is Jesus Christ.
How should Christians pray for the Palestinians?
We need some actions more than prayers. Prayers are great, you know, and prayers start the desire in our hearts and our minds that we have to take a step. A prayer by itself is not enough. We need to pray hard and be motivated and do something about it. To Palestinians, I'm saying that Jesus Christ didn't come to take sides. He came to take over. We can do it. And we have stories of millions of people coming to Christ today. Let's at least support the ministries who are evangelizing in the Middle East, like Al Hayat TV, the satellite TV. It's a great, great ministry to Muslims to expose Islam and evangelize to them. So we need to support those people. It breaks my heart when I hear that they don't have money for airing, for example. And I see all type of money going for other things. I think this is priority number one. And it's very, very important mission for Christians today.
Mosab Hassan Youssef, son of Hamas. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
In his book, Mosab also talks about the 10 years he spent as an agent spying on Hamas for the Israeli intelligence service. Hear more about that story at our website, cwnews.org. We'll be right back.
I'm Gary Haven, founder and CEO of Curves. I first read The Secret Kingdom. It appeared at a time where I had just hit rock bottom. The Secret Kingdom played a big part in Curve's success. It taught us those basic biblical principles that, if applied, allowed God to bless us. Today, we're the ninth largest of any franchise company. We do business in 80 countries. We're the largest fitness franchise in America, in Canada, in Japan, Brazil. It's been an amazing story. Had I not learned the principles in the Secret Kingdom, Diane and I would probably be in Harlingen, Texas, running two Curves, helping hundreds of women, but millions of women might still be suffering. This year, that company, along with all the franchisees, is a $2 billion a year company. And that's a miracle.
Ready in the set?
Going to Dr. Robertson in 3, 2.
On December 3rd, 2009, Pat Robertson entered the studio to update his landmark work, The Secret Kingdom, to help people live abundant lives amid today's challenges.
I want to talk to you today about The Secret Kingdom. What is The Secret Kingdom?
The Secret Kingdom, Volume 1, available now.
Christian World News, your window to the global church. For stories of revival.
Another revival.
Persecution.
Funeral, relatives and fellow Christians born in
first country over the international dateline.
I'm George Thomas in Baghdad, and coming up on the broadcast, an exclusive interview.
And the impact of Christian leaders. Watch Christian World News.
Finally this week, the Christ of the Andes statue in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, was voted one of the 7 modern wonders of the world in 2007. Now, it's getting ready for a facelift. The goal is to protect the 130-foot tall monument from damage caused by the environment. The statue was first inaugurated back in 1931. Renovations should be finished in June. And that's all for this edition of Christian World News. Thanks so much for joining us. Until next week, from all of us here, goodbye and God bless you.